How's that sound? How's everyone? Are we recording? Sound as well? Awesome.
We didn't plan our outfits, they just happened. And then the red tape happened as well. All matches.
Yeah. Don't know why red's today, but...
Yeah. Luby was saying it's something to do with the talk topic that we're going to have, but we haven't decided what the talk topic is. So.
And we thought actually with such a group that it'd probably be better to more have a bit of interaction with you guys, like in terms of questions that you want to ask and so forth. And so what we've done, we've got microphones so that there's Anto on that side and then there's
Vlad
on the other side. And so if you have any questions, just if you can hold the microphones up sort of and speak into them so you can hear yourself in the sound system, that would be lovely. And then we can get a recording of those too. So, yeah. Some of you are a bit disappointed about the numbers of people here. Why is that? Don't need to be disappointed. Tuesday night, we're having another time here if you want to come along. And then Saturday and Sunday next week, we're in Albury, up at on the border in New South Wales. And then during the week, I think it was Wednesday night, isn't it?
Wednesday
night, yep. We're over at Mildura. And then the following Saturday, so 2 weekends' time, we're back down here on the Saturday. So that's the way. And then myself and Mary fly home and Lena and Igor drive all the sound equipment and everything home.
Yeah, we're going to be home for a week and a half and then we're going to Greece for 3 weeks to do some talks. So,
yeah.
Yeah, it's exciting.
Yeah, so we're looking forward to that. Yeah. Anyway, we haven't got any specific subject that we wanted to talk with you today about, but we would love to answer any of the questions that you have.
Who's completely brand new? Who's never... Yep.
So a few.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Welcome. Yeah.
Yeah. And so how many of you who are completely brand new, you've definitely seen some DVDs or something like that? Yeah? Okay. So we actually we're going to have ready to give away DVDs at this session, but the DVDs haven't finished being printed yet. But there are 50... copies, I think you said, Joy, 50 copies of Last Time We Were in Melbourne.
Almost exactly a year ago.
Which is, close to a year ago, that are all available should you want to take them with you today. They're all for free, so you don't have to pay for them or anything. They're over there, and I think they're fairly clearly labelled, aren't they, Joy? And if you want to place a donation for the DVDs, then there's a box over there for donations if you want to put some money in. Your money helps us print more DVDs. By next, not this coming
Tuesday,
but by the last weekend here in Melbourne, there will be a complete set of 10 DVDs that we've done that Igor's just remastered for each of you to take with you if you would like to have a copy. And if you're not going to be here then, just if you could let Anto and Jane know, via email. Have you got an email address that you're happy to... Yeah. Good. If you can just write it up for us, I'll just get my...
And the set is like an introductory set, if you like. It's got Secrets of the Universe, Longing for Divine Love, Longing for Divine Truth, Humility and Prayer. So even if you've got them, you might want to give them to somebody else, and that's fine as well if you want to take a copy. So...
So if you could, email the guys if you're not going to be around two Saturdays' time. But if you are, there'll be a set here ready for you. We got 300 or 400 sets printed, so yeah, there'd be plenty. Should be plenty. Depends how many people are, I suppose, at Albury, but I think there'll only be around 100 or so there. So, yeah. Okay. Fire away, people. Warm up. All shy. It's nobody coming along and don't want to say anything. Face your fear and go ahead. Good on you. There's a mic right by you.
It's freaking me out being recorded. last time I was at the workshop, I spoke to you about my chronic fatigue and my hook into people needing their approval.
And how much you're desiring, you're willing to sacrifice your entire life almost for their approval.
Well, I have in the past.
Of course you have, yeah. Yep.
Now I sort of feel like I'm being physically attacked sometimes by spirits because I have days when I just deteriorate so dramatically and so quickly.
Yep.
It's scaring me. But I'm confused what the hook is into them. Like, what do they get from me?
Okay, well, let's draw what's happening for you. How's that? So here's Elvira. Sorry about the dress, Elvira. Right. You, because of a certain emotional condition, so if you imagine if you had no emotional injuries at all, what would happen is you would have a nice, smooth, what people call an aura, but it's really actually a smooth, protective barrier around yourself. So no person would be able to hook into any emotion that you have and draw from you, and you wouldn't be able to hook into anyone else's emotion either or draw from them in that state because you'll also be loving, right? Now, as soon as you have an emotional injury, then there's a crack or a hole in that aura or that field, if you like, of protection around yourself. And the more emotional injuries we have, the more cracks there are, if you like, into ourselves. So you can imagine it like these are sort of like almost energy vortexes now, and that's how they actually look to the spirits. There's energy vortexes that through those cracks enter certain parts of our body. Does that make sense? And any spirit or any person, so it doesn't matter whether the person's in the spirit world, right? Or on earth, so if they're here on earth next to you, they can draw from energy from you as a result of those cracks. So what's happening for yourself quite frequently now is that you're trying to see, oh well, I've got something going on with this person on earth, and I've got something going on with that person on earth, and you're trying to at least address some of those things that you've got going on with the people on earth. But the problem is there's all these spirits that surround you, and these spirits also know every one of those cracks, right? And they will attempt to draw your energy from you wherever they can. That's their desire. And their desires are all based around what they want out of the interaction. And then your allowance of it is about what you want from the interaction or what you allow from the interaction. You see, a lot of times we don't want something specifically, but we feel like we have to give it. So something that's happened in your life a lot, for example, with women, is that you feel like you've got to do things for them no matter what they're demanding from you. So that's one of the emotional holes, if you like. So if I was a woman in the spirit world, I would see that hole and I'd go, all I've got to do is pressurise Elvira a bit and she'll automatically allow me to draw from her emotionally. Right?
What emotion do they get from me? Like, I don't understand. That has always confused me about what it is that spirits can conceivably get.
Well, one emotion they get from you is your fear. In other words, they can project something at you, like be nasty towards you, and they feel you go afraid, and they like that. Because what that does is it gives them a feeling that they're more powerful than you. Does that make sense? It gives them a feeling that they're in control of you. So some of the spirits who are around you are addicted to your fear. They like seeing you afraid. They like seeing you feel like scared for your life, in fact, right? And if you think about the last few weeks in particular, you can feel some of that fear. When you start getting quite ill, you can feel that almost that fear for your life almost kicking in as well. And that's what they love to see happen to you. They love you being afraid for your life. It makes them feel powerful and in control of you. And some of them laugh at that and some of them are condescending towards that. Others are actually just quite vicious and they just like to have that feeling of power over you. Does that make sense?
So I need to go into the fear of that.
The fear that you might die, that is one of the fears they're playing upon. Does that make sense? The fear, you have a number of other fears. Fears about embracing a desirous life, a life of desire. Does that make sense? So you think back and over your life, every time desire has come along, you've almost been in two minds. Like, because, or if I could say it more like what it really is, you really have two feelings that are almost opposing each other. One is, I would love to follow that desire. The other is, I'm scared as hell about that desire, you know, like about following that desire and where that's going to lead me. And so what they do is they manipulate you through your fear. So fear is a big part of what they're doing with you. They cause you to become so afraid that that you're willing to give to them, yourself almost, energy-wise, you're willing to give yourself to them just to prevent their fear, prevent their rage towards you or their anger towards you.
And it's the resistance to feeling that fear that is allowing them to draw the energy from you. So when you soften into the fear and you just let yourself feel how terrified you are that they're going to attack you and harm you or reject you heavily, like a lot of the approval addiction is about just avoiding the horrible ostracism that you fear. If you can soften into the fear, then it feels scary, but you'll still have your energy.
Yeah.
It's the resistance to the fear that's causing the draining.
So the key thing to remember is that every time you resist the actual fear emotion, which is something that you've done most of your life, you began to do it, you were taught how to do it from your childhood, but you've been doing it most of your life now. So it's a pattern that has been built up over your life. And as you start stepping into your fear, you'll find spirits and others can hurt you less, actually. Most of us are afraid that with fear, if we step into our fear, people are about to harm us more, right? So most of us think that we're going to get harmed more, we'll be more open and more vulnerable and more, and all these things. So we worry so much about that we resist our fears. But the irony is that when you feel your fear, the hole that allows somebody else to control your fear gets patched up. Does that make sense? So when you feel your own fear, the irony is the hole that allows somebody else to control your fear is no longer present in that moment. And so in that moment, you can no longer be influenced by the external person. It's about having a loyalty to the truth in a lot of ways. Like once we have this loyalty to the truth, fear does not become the dominant thing controlling our lives anymore. And what's happening for yourself is that fear is quite a dominant part of control, and so that's open. And now anybody who basically, all to control you, all somebody really needs to do is tell you that you're a bad person, that you've, you know, done bad things in your life and you should be ashamed of yourself, and a few other things like that, or even less blunt than that, in this interaction you're not being nice to me, and all of a sudden you will feel like you've done the wrong thing and have to be nice. Does that make sense? So because of that, they're sort of manipulating the fear that you have of being disapproved of, and they're manipulating that through that opening, and now they really have control. All they've got to do is make a few suggestions to you that you're bad and you're this and you're that, and all of a sudden you'll try harder, give more, which is what the problem is. This is what causes the chronic fatigue, is the desire to give more and more and more and more to placate the fear that you can't feel inside of yourself.
I've been like crying and shaking now since I started watching your videos.
Yep.
Have I been just doing capping emotions or?
Well, the other problem you face, Avira, and it's going to take a little bit of time for you to work through this, is you also have surrounding you a group of women spirits, right, who are very, very afraid. And they feel your fear and they commiserate with it. In other words, they feel like, don't you go and feel your fear. We've got to try and get away from our fear. We've got to do whatever we can to help you avoid your fear, and so forth and so forth. But a lot of times when you start processing, you actually, because of this willingness to feel other people's emotions that you have quite strongly, you're allowing them to process through you, right? And as a result of that, they get to feel some of their fear through you, and they get to feel some of their grief through you. And this is because there's very, at the moment, it's very hard for you to determine what is the end of you and what's the beginning of another person. Does that make sense? They almost feel, at the moment, like they're you, even. That's how close they are to you. They almost feel like they are you. And so a lot of times you're very willing to feel their emotions, but also avoiding your own in that moment. So you'll be crying, but actually, and to be frank, many people are doing this still. They're crying, but they're actually crying somebody else's emotion or in commiseration with somebody else's emotion. They're not actually crying their own life. They're actually feeling about another person's life.
Can I add to that just about processing fear? Because I've put a lot of focus on that in the last few months, and I found that stepping into desire and action, taking action, not in the sense of like, okay, I'm afraid of heights, I'm going to jump out of an aeroplane. No, first connect to what is my desire? What do I feel the truth is in this situation? Now I'm going to stay true to that and step into whatever this experience is, like this interaction but with me and another person. And that is the time when I've released the most fear and been triggered, and I've had to leave the interaction sometimes and go and process. But I feel that the danger of processing fear when we're not challenging our desires or our actions, because that's the thing that limits our actions and desires, is fear. When we're not stepping into that, just focusing on this, I'm going to take a new action or I'm going to step into this desire, that can trigger our fear much more than just sort of sitting going, okay, I'm afraid of other people, I'll just feel that. If it's not changing in my interactions with other people, I know I'm not releasing the fear, because immediately that I start releasing the fear of other people, my interactions with other people will change. But also, my experience is when I step into more interactions with people, first recognising what is the truth, what is my addiction, how am I going to challenge this, then step into the interaction, my fears have been challenged and released far more rapidly. Does that make sense?
Would you mind giving an example of something that you've done recently? Because I always understand best when somebody...
Sure. Yep. So I've got a lot of terror about spirits. And so I started running the mediumship team in God's Way of Love organisation that we've just launched. And there's a number of people in that team who have been very spirit influenced in the past and very attacking as a result towards myself and AJ. And at the opening of the first meeting, I said, guys, we need to talk about this. We need to talk about the fact that spirit influence can happen and how we're going to deal with it. How as a team can we make sure that we don't make this a venue, if you like, for spirits to influence all of us into other interactions that aren't authentic. And so we agreed that we would ask the person who's spirit influenced, give them the truth and ask them to leave, and they could come back at a time when they weren't so overcloaked. By the end of the first meeting, someone with some spirits who very violently opposed to myself and AJ, specifically myself, someone became very influenced by them, and I could feel my fear. And I thought, if I don't submit to this fear in my interaction with this person, I'm going to get resistive, or I'm going to get angry with them and try and shut them down. So because I wanted to stay in the in a loving space with this whole group, I went, I'm going to have to soften into this fear. And I stood and shook and talked to the person about what I could feel was happening, and we spoke at length. And eventually he couldn't see what was happening, so eventually I had to ask him to leave, and he was very angry with me. But during the whole process, I remained connected to myself, because this is the beautiful thing about when we soften into our fear, we stay in connection with ourselves. We know what is loving in that space, even if we might be shaking. And so I shook and asked him to leave, and since then I feel less fear of those kind of interactions. But I had to challenge it in the moment.
for yourself, Vera, anger is the result of the underlying fear not being felt. So whenever you feel frustrated or angry, it's because you're not allowing yourself to feel the underlying fear. So if anger is your guide into what you're avoiding. So you know straight away if any time you feel just a moment or a tinge even of frustration, whatever it's about, it might even be about the fact that you're feeling ill, right? And you feel quite angry that you're feeling sick. Allow yourself to realise, actually, this is covering over my fear about feeling sick. Does that make sense? And allow yourself to go into that fear and feel that fear instead of trying to avoid it through anger or avoid it by doing. So you'll do usually one of two different things. When somebody projects at you, I want you to do what I want, you'll either do what they want, which is a way of avoiding your terror of them when you don't do what they want, or you'll go in and you'll feel quite ill. You'll actually create more physical ailment within yourself as a way of excusing yourself from doing what they want. Does that make sense? So the creation of the sickness is actually helping you avoid what they're projecting at you without actually having to say to them, you're actually wanting me to do something and no, I'm not going to. You can now say to them, I'm sorry, but I can't help you because I'm feeling sick and I really need to rest. Does that make sense? It's a way of actually avoiding the confrontation emotion. So the way the spirits around you and people around you manipulate you is they project the rage, if you like, to you, or to be more honest, it's the threat of rage to you. So in other words, you're very, very sensitive to people who potentially could become rageful with you. So they most of the time they don't, because you're already doing what they want. Does that make sense to you? So because you're already doing what they want, they're not going to get into rage with you. What you're scared of is stopping doing what they want, and then they'll get into a rage with you. And the way to avoid that then is to have actually an illness where you go, oh, I'm too sick to do what you want. You follow me? And it's a great way of actually not having to confront their rage, because they at least might have some compassion for your sickness and therefore not be angry with you for not doing what they wanted you to do in the first place. Now, in terms of the original question you asked was the codependency. In other words, what are you addicted to getting from them? Right? Well, firstly, what you're doing is you're addicted to preventing their potential anger. Does that make sense? How does it feel when somebody's angry with you?
My dad scared the crap out of me.
Yeah, yeah. And how do you feel about yourself when they're angry with you?
Helpless.
Yep. Yep. And if you allow yourself to settle even further down, you'll find actually there's quite a few emotions in how you feel when they're angry with you. Terrible feelings inside of yourself about yourself. Like, you almost blame yourself for another person's anger with you.
Yeah, I wasn't good enough to stop it.
Yep. So in other words, this person who is potentially, so I probably should write that there, potentially in a rage with you. In other words, they have this underlying soul condition where they could easily get into a rage with you if you didn't give them what they wanted. Right? And there's that automatic threat that, well, you think about your parents, and that threat has come from them quite strongly when you were little, right? This automatic threat, unless you do what I want, then we're going to have trouble here. And after a while, the child learns that I've just got to always do what they want. And then I avoid their rage. That's how I avoid their rage. So I just do, and eventually exhaust myself doing to avoid their rage. So what you're addicted to is avoiding other people's rage. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Avoiding the emotion that comes from them to you when you don't do what they want. That's what you're avoiding. And those emotions are all sorts of emotions, ranging from condescension right the way through to just bare violence. And you have a range of people around you like that. who, you know, would just be condescending towards you, right the way through to somebody who would just be, like, you know, angry and really quite violent with you. And if you think back at your childhood again, same pattern going on there. So after a while, we become so addicted to having this person not be angry with me that I'll do almost anything they want in order to prevent them from being angry with me. Right? And there's my hole. My hole is, actually, I need to learn that it's okay for the other person to be angry with me. I'm still not going to do what they want, even when they're angry with me. And even if they're condescending towards me, and even if they tell me that I'm a bitch or a bastard, and even if they tell me that, you know, that I, you know, they're going to try to harm me, and all of those kind of things, I'm still not going to do what they want. And in fact, for myself, what happens with me, the more a person treats me that way, the less chance there is of me doing what they want. For yourself, the more they treat you that way, the more chance there is of you doing what they want. Do you see? There's a big difference between those two states. So the key is to allow yourself to see how frightened you are. And in a way, I would say the underlying causal emotion is partly about how much you can't trust God, that God's going to protect you in an angry situation. And that is a really deep childhood feeling that you have, that you weren't protected in angry situations. So the key is to allow yourself to embrace that grief that's just there while I'm talking about it. That's it. And just allow yourself to embrace that grief fully and let yourself fully feel that, no, God's not going to protect me, so I've got to come up with some alternative arrangement here. And the alternative arrangement is I'll do whatever they want. That's the alternative.
And would you say that is really the block to Alvira processing her fear? Because
yes.
At the moment you touch into your fear and go, no, I can't do this because I'm not going to be protected. Whereas once you grieve this feeling that God's not going to be there, you'll have more faith. And then when you hit your fear, you'll go, it's okay, I can just surrender to this fear.
And God will help me through the whole process. God will help me deal with this emotion.
I've actually been surprised every time I go into something, somewhere in there is God.
Yeah.
And the fact that I don't trust him.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I've raged at God and... But I don't know how to build that trust.
Could I discuss with the whole group how to build trust in God? That'd be a good thing to talk about, I think. And there's some really simple and direct things you can do to slowly build your trust in God and get to know God better. And in fact, I definitely feel that's probably
that
a thing
our
that
moot topic for today. So definitely the right thing.
So does that sound good for you? I feel that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I feel that for many of you, you're doing emotional work, which is great. But you're forgetting the reason why we're doing emotional work. It's only so that we can connect to God better. That's the only real reason, right? Now, if inside of myself I don't, one, believe God really exists anyway, two, feel that God's an entity, three, feel that God's very trustworthy, four, feel that I can have any faith in God being good, if I have none of those things happening, then how am I ever going to want to deal with an emotion that's preventing my relationship with God when I already have all these blocks towards God anyway? So what we need to do is it all hard to come off, is it? So what we need to do is we need to come to understand some basic ways in which we can get to know God better and come to trust her, right? And for many of us, it's the lack of trust in God and the lack of faith in God that when we hit a certain emotion that's quite dark and deep within us, we automatically stop. Because what else do we do when we're self-reliant? When we're self-reliant, we have this tendency to hit the emotion. We go as deep as our self-reliance will allow us, but not deep enough to release the emotion, right? And as a result, because there's this gap about how we feel about God dictating most of our life, we don't actually go through into that really dark place that is going to be the real rip out of the emotion out of us and it will be gone. So what happens is we get so deep till self-reliance kicks in and we go, no, I can't do any more now. That's it. Now I'm frightened. Now I'm terrified. Now I can't go further. And we even say to ourselves, and many of you have probably even said, I can't do this. I can't do this. We tell ourselves these messages constantly that we can't do it. And so what we want to do is find a way in which to get to know God. And by the way, for many of you guys that are struggling with your emotions, this next part is also really good. Because what I find in many of our discussions is a fellow will come up to me and say, look, I have a lot of trouble getting to my emotions. And I go, well, actually, it's not really about getting into your emotions. It's really about getting to know God. And then in the process, you'll get to feel some emotion. You know, it's sort of the emotional side is really a subsequent result of your desire to get to know God, not the other way around. And then I get asked, well, I don't really believe God, or I don't really believe that God exists, or, you know, all those, how can I know? Yeah. And the basis of how you can know, I'll go through with you now, I feel. That'd be a good thing to talk about.
Could I just talk about that a little bit as well? Just that in the last 6 months, that has been my focus. It's been about God and creating this relationship. That is the basis of this path, but I too neglected for a long time because I was very caught up in who I was and not wanting to be that person and all these other issues and emotions, a lot of my family stuff. And I never stopped and went, this is about me connecting with God and getting to know who me really is, whoever that might be. And just stopping and focusing on that and exercising my desire to know and understand God brought me lots of different books and experiences. And it's also really empowered me in this emotional process. Like I really want my emotions now because I really want God. And God isn't this like religious ew figure that I kind of had, you know, had a lot of baggage about, you know, God and religion being the one thing and being controlling and hypocritical and all of these things. And really stopping and feeling who is God and how much do I want God has really helped me so much. So I feel it's such a beautiful topic to talk about.
Mm.
And one I'm quite passionate about. Yeah. Mm. The other thing, though, was a lot of people have a lot of issues with trust with AJ. He's saying he's Jesus. That's a pretty big deal. And it triggers emotions for everyone on the planet, let's face it. Whether we want to feel about that yet or not, it's definitely there. And I was speaking to a group recently and I was saying that for myself, I also had a lot of issues with trust with AJ. And I also had a lot of issues with trusting what I felt was this other identity, who I am, and really taking my focus to God and developing that relationship and trusting that God can teach me these things has streamlined not only my emotional processing but this relationship, because I'm not having to trust AJ. I'm not even really having to trust, I have to trust what I feel. But beyond that, I get to trust someone who really knows what he's talking about. And that I feel for everyone on this path, it's not about us. We're here to teach it, but really please know it's about God. It's not even about your emotions. Yes, we're emotional beings, but in the end, it's about God, and it's the best relationship ever. That's why we stand up here and just talk about all these different things, is only in the hope that you might know God a little bit better. Because once you make that connection, you don't need us anymore. You know? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So what we'll do is we'll go through how to get to know God, shall we? In a really practical, down-to-earth, pragmatic way. Yeah, yeah. Does that make sense? Something that makes will make a lot of sense to you. All right. Well, let's focus firstly on the issue of truth. Now, I don't mean God's truth here, and I don't mean your truth either. I mean, in this case, what I'm talking about is there are basically three categories that we can put most things in when it comes to truth. One category is, yeah, I don't believe that's true, right? So let's call that category number one. Let's call it, I think of these things as piles of pieces of paper that I've put together from summarising different things that have happened in my life, right? So here's pile number one, which is basically all the things I don't know. Now, of course, that pile is pretty big, is it not? Like, you think of all the things you possibly could possibly know in the universe, and for the majority of us, that pile is probably the largest pile of all three piles, right? All the things that we don't know. Or we could say there are the things we don't believe, and we don't even know what we don't believe at this point, because it's just stuff that we have never learned about. Then there's another pile. Usually this pile, I might draw this pile a little smaller actually, wherever that razor went. Yeah. Thank you, babe. Sorry. So this pile's usually much smaller. And this is all the things I think I know. Now, for many people, that is still a pretty large pile because often we have a very inflated viewpoint of what we know. And so, you know, we have quite a large pile that we think it should be in that category. And then for the majority of us, there's this third avenue. And a lot of times at the beginning, it's and particularly when it comes to what we know about God, a lot of times this pile is almost non-existent. This is what I definitely know and feel as truth. Whoops, truth doesn't get spelt that way. Truth.
So it's like the for sure, the maybe, and no idea piles.
Does that make sense? So as Mary just suggested, you can think of these piles in a lot easier way. This is, I'm sure. This is, I think I'm sure.
Maybe.
Or maybe. And this is, no idea. Agreed? Okay, now, if you think about all truth like this, this is all through my life, the last 2,000 years, this is how I've approached everything. Everything I've ever done in terms of discovering of truth, this has basically been my approach. That I basically am aware that there's a huge amount of things I don't know. I also am aware that there's things I think I know, but they might not be true. Or they might be, just who knows.
Like, so is that part of like a hypothesis?
This is like it's almost like a hypothetical. I'm testing it. Yeah. So things in this pile are the tests that I put in place, really, about truth. But then there's this one thing I discovered in the first century quite early was that there was things that I knew for sure, no matter what anybody else thought or said to me, I knew that what they were saying or thinking, when it was in disharmony with what I felt to be true, it was definitely wrong. So one of the things I learned quite early was about my relationship with God, that there is a God who is an entity, and that was something that I knew for sure. Quite early in my life in the first century, and we'll talk about why I knew that as we progress. So if you think that every single truth that you could ever ask a question about, so is there such a thing as the law of attraction? Well, when we first hear the law of attraction, we go, I've never heard of that, right? So that's in that pile. And then we start to experiment a bit with it, and we start to do some things with it generally, and we get to this pile where, well, I think there might be such a thing as this law of attraction. I seem to experiment with it a bit, and how it works, I've got no idea really. But you know, I experiment, and before I know it, things become real. And then once things start to really gel, and I go, wow, this law of attraction is not about what everybody thinks. It's not the mind being exercised to think about something and all of a sudden it comes, but rather it's about desires and passions of the soul influencing the whole thing. And once I start exercising my desire and passion of the soul, and all of a sudden things are attracted and I notice the attraction instantly, I'm going, wow, there's a direct correlation between what's going on in my soul and what I'm attracting right now, right at this moment. That direct correlation is happening. And once I hit into that knowing, now I can put it into my for sure basket. Now, what happens for many of us when it comes to this process is we have a lot of judgment of the process. So in other words, when you're asked a question, is this true or not, most of us have an emotion, whereas if I go, I don't know, then they're going to think I'm an idiot. So it's best for me to say, well, I think I know that it is, you know what I mean? Or even say that it is when I'm not really sure. In other words, we start to falsify what we feel sure about inside of ourselves just for the sake of pleasing somebody else emotionally. That's what we do, right? And most of us have gotten used to doing that so much that most of the time we try to live in this place here. In other words, where we think we know the truth and we're quite definite about it, quite sure about it. But actually, if we're really honest with ourselves, we're not really sure. We just think we're sure. It's a maybe, really, inside of ourselves. But we're not honest about enough with ourselves because we're worried about what everyone's going to think if I don't have a specific opinion. And this relates a lot to childhood emotions regarding our parents, right? If we didn't have their opinion, then automatically we were wrong. How does that apply to your life? Most of you would be that wouldn't it? Your mums and your fathers, how many of them were allowing of you having a completely different opinion to them without them in some way being upset with you? Like, it's a fairly rare parent that actually can do that, and it's a very good parent who can do that too, by the way. So there we are. There are our three poles. Now, how does all this apply to discovering God? Well, if we put God at the top of this truth, so this now we're talking about the truth about God. The fact is that the majority of us don't know anything about God when we begin, right?
And even after we watch The Secrets of the Universe, we go, oh, wow, right. We can then want to just put ourselves in this sure pile, but the truth is we haven't had that discovery for ourselves. We've heard about it and gone, I think there's something in this, but...
And we're fascinated by it, but that doesn't make it real.
And right? We've got to stop kidding ourselves that it's real. We've got to go, no, this is my personal relationship and I have to discover this.
So we need to learn to be very truthful about everything and including God. So to be frank at the moment for most of the audience, the truth is there are a lot of things you think are maybe true about God, but as yet they are not certainties. Now, let's look at one of them that you raised over it. Trust in God. Now, if God was a certainty, and I knew for certain that God was loving all the time, and I knew for certain that all of God's laws were always loving, and I knew for certain that God viewed me as a precious child that could have a relationship, and I knew those things for certain, do you think I'd ever not trust her? Of course not. So the fact that I don't trust her means that I don't know those things for certain. Does that make sense to everyone? The proof is... in our life, if we're still being self-reliant, then we don't know God for certain. And that's okay. Don't judge that. Just see it as, this is the truth. This is the truth of where I'm at right at the beginning. Where I'm at right now is that I've got a very small shore pile about God. Right? Now, to be frank, some of us don't even have a shore pile about whether God exists or not at this point. And we're trying to follow the divine love path... without even feeling for certain that God exists. What's the point of doing that? I might as well firstly go through a process of finding out whether God exists or not, surely.
And this is where a lot of guys get their partners going, you've got to feel your emotions, you've got to feel your emotions, you've got to feel your emotions.
He's going, what's the point of feeling my emotions? I don't even believe there's a God yet.
And they go, it's all about emotions. And they miss that it's about God. So,
does that make sense? So a lot of times we find that the feminine side of the soul, shall we say, is they're trying to bully the masculine side of the soul into feeling an emotion, right? But in reality, the masculine side of the soul is going to the feminine side. So hang on a sec, do you even believe God exists yet? Right? And if she's honest with herself, she goes, no, I don't really trust God yet, so I mustn't really believe God exists or that God is loving or something else about God, huh?
Yeah. And the cool thing, though, is that this is the most beautiful, important process you're going to go through in your whole soul's existence.
Yep.
So it's okay if at the beginning this is like racked high and there's nothing here.
Yep.
Every time...
Don't be scared of that.
Every time something moves across, it's a precious moment in the history of your soul. Don't try and fake it. Just let it happen, you know, and let yourself be vulnerable with yourself and maybe with God that, hey, I don't know you. I don't know what's going on. This is all a big, like, jungle I'm in here, and I know there's emotions and I think you might be loving, but I'm not sure yet. And allow this process of that AJ's going to explain a bit more to happen, recognising that every time there's just one more sheet of paper on the shore pile, it's precious. You'll never lose that, and it's going to stay with you for the life of your entire soul, which goes long beyond this earthly plane. So it's like it's a cool adventure for me, you know? And a lot of us get really pressured, like, oh, God, emotions, path, got to do it. When really, if we see this as a voyage of discovery, that we're getting to start really in the nursery of our soul, it's pretty exciting.
For me, it's an everlasting voyage. It's not something that has a goal at the end of it, in the sense that I'm just getting closer to God, closer to God, closer to God of what I know for certain.
But there's still things in this pile.
Yeah. Yeah. Does that make sense? And, like, there's a lot of things about God herself that are still in that pile for me. Right? The key is to not judge it. Now, the things that are in that pile for me about God will maybe quite a lot less than the things in that pile for you about God, but the key is to not judge where we're each at either. We want to assist each other to come to see the truth, and we want to do it in such a way that's both logical and feeling at the same time, not just illogical but feeling, or logic only and no feeling. We want to do it in an embrace, a way that embraces, because it's only when you feel the truth as certainty that it actually changes your life. That's the only time. You can think anything. It is not going to change your life until you feel it as a certainty. Yeah. Is there any questions about it so far? Because we're talking here about the discovery of truth generally and the process to embrace, if you like, in the discovery of truth. Yeah. No questions, and we can proceed. So now what we want to do is we now want to focus on the truth about God. Because to me, and if we think about it logically, God knows all truth. So it would make sense from a logical perspective that if there is a God, right, then that God would be the creator of all things. And as the creator of all things, would then know all truth. And it would then make sense that if I could have a personal relationship with that God, I will discover truth far more rapidly than I would using any other form of experimentation. So most of us, when we experiment, so, you know, the scientific methods of experimenting, they're the kind of methods like, okay, what I'm going to do is I'll set up an experiment to test whether an atom exists. Now, I might have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars setting up this experiment to test whether an atom exists and how the atom exists. And I do all of these series of experiments, and really what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to prove how it doesn't exist. All right? So I finish up. So the scientific method is about proving the non-existence, and then what's left must be true. That's often what happens. Now, to me, my focus is more the opposite way of that. And I feel like the first question I needed to resolve was whether God existed. Because if I resolve the God existence question, then it would make sense that if God exists, I can now start discovering things about that God. And then hopefully, if God exists, that I can also develop some kind of personal relationship with God and find out through that relationship all the other things that exist, whatever they be, right? So to me, the question of the truth about God is the most important question that you could ever ask yourself or that you can ever discover. Uh-huh. And all other questions in my feelings now were from a long time ago, my feelings are all other questions you could ask are almost have little significance without first answering this question. But you see, what most of us do emotionally is this. Most of us go, well, you know, I've had a religious upbringing or a painful experience. I've had a religious upbringing or a painful experience. And so I want to believe there is no God before I begin. Right? That's what I want. How many of us want to believe in a God that's, you know, fear-inspiring, that punishes people, you know, that torments you for in hellfire for the rest of your life if you do one thing wrong, and you're never going to get to heaven if you do one thing wrong, and then who defines what's right and wrong? Well, that God does, but has he told me everything that's right and wrong? No. So, it all seems very confusing, and in the end, I go, well, I'd just rather prefer to believe that God, as an entity, doesn't exist. And then you can see how in the New Age movement, what happens is that many then go into this feeling that, well, God's an energy and not an entity, right? And it helps get away a lot of things that way, because if God was an entity and we see all these unloving things happening around us, we go, well, God mustn't be very nice, right? So we can't accept that God isn't very nice. So let's accept that God is an energy instead. In other words, is an uncaring, unfeeling powerhouse. Basically, that's what many of us would prefer God to be as well. And we get away with a lot of emotions that way, don't we? We get to deny a lot of emotions about resolving questions about God that way. So once we start to focus on, all right, this question, whether God exists, so I'll just write God back into the equation. We're starting out in the fact that basically all of the piles are all in this pile, all in the no idea pile. Right? Where we've basically just got no idea. When somebody says, well, what's God look like? I got no idea. And somebody says, well, what does God feel like? Oh, I've got no idea either. I don't even know whether God has feelings. And we go, well, did God create everything? I've got no idea.
Is God real?
Is God real? I don't really know. I've never felt God, so I don't know whether God's real or not. So the truth is, when we begin in this process of discovery of God, we've really got no idea about most of it, right?
Someone's up here going, no, God's good, and entity loves you, it's all going to be good. You don't feel that in your heart, do you? You're going, I don't know.
And the truth is, I can get up here and say, look, I've felt God and met God and all everything else, but it's really immaterial to you, if you think about it, because you haven't felt God or met God in the same way. So you're just going on my statement. And what's the point of that? That's not a personal experience where you know inside of your own heart for sure the truth. So even that sort of, while it might sound inspiring and it might sound beautiful what I describe or whatever, you still can't really trust it until you go through some kind of personal experience about the whole thing. Right? So everyone gets that the personal experience has to be gone through rather than just trusting what anybody else says to you about any subject, but in particular about the subject of God. Yeah? So what do I do? What would you do, given that almost every question you ask is in the no idea pile about God? What would you do now? What would be your next course of action, knowing that? To ask questions would be your next course of action, wouldn't it?
So that immediately puts us some things in the hypothesis or the test pile, doesn't it?
Yep.
Okay, I don't know. I'll ask this guy. He reckons God's good. All right.
I got no idea whether God's good. In fact, if I'm really honest with myself, if God does exist and if God's good, then why the hell do we have so much badness on the planet? Right? To me, that's an indication that God's bad, actually. Not that God is good. So my first hypothesis might be this. God is bad. God is punishing. Right? And there's a whole group of consequent feelings that we will have about all that. So I have a whole list of things that I think are true. I think, and I need to be honest with myself about this for this whole process to work. Like, as soon as I get dishonest with myself, I'm going to get away from this process actually having any benefit to me. So I need to be honest with myself. God's bad, for sure. My feelings is that, like, God is bad because you look at, there's 50 million children die pretty much every day on this planet. 50 million children under 5 years of age die every day on this planet. Now, if God cared about anything, surely God would care about those children. Yeah? So to me, those children dying straight away means that God is bad. If God exists, that is. Can you see? And I need to be truthful about with that feeling about that I feel within myself, that that's what I feel. Right? My mother has been in a religion most of her life, and she's been in a few different religions in her life, and the whole point of being in a religion is to worship God, is it not? When in most cases that's what people think, but my mum still hasn't resolved the question whether God is good or not. In fact, she still has a feeling in herself that God is bad. Would you go to church every week with that feeling? Well, to be frank, there's millions of people on this planet who go to church every week with the feeling that God is bad. And they still go to church every week. Now, it's a very important question to resolve, isn't it? So, God is bad. God is punishing. They are the things that I think I know about God. So I start testing it. How could I test it? The feeling that God is bad. How do I test that? So on one hand, I've got all this evidence. All this evidence that children die every day for no reason. You know, parents hurt children. You know, you see that happening all the time. You know,
my parents hurt me. Where was God?
My parents hurt me. Where was God in that process? I often scream to God to not, you know, to not get hurt. And I still got hurt. Can you feel? Can you feel the energy in the room?
I never thought we were going to go to this place.
Right? Can you see that many of us are not honest that we have some of those feelings in us? Right? Can you see that? And the fact that the energy is going down, you've got spirits now, many of whom also feel what I just stated—that God is bad. Their energy is affecting yours and connecting with yours and. Before you know it, the energy in the room goes really dark and gloomy about God, right? But we need to be honest, but we need to have more of an investigative nature with it. So at this point, what a lot of persons would do is they'd say, God is bad, God is punishing, I've got the proof, that's it. I don't want to know anything more. Now, the problem with that is that if God does exist, and God would therefore be infinite. And if God is infinite, then maybe what we know about God is very finite, and maybe my perspective that God is bad has some problems associated with it.
So in this process, I have to be willing to recognise I don't know everything yet,
yep.
And be willing to ask questions, like someone over here said. So I have to go, okay, this is the evidence I've got, and it feels really crappy, and you know, I'd like to hold on to this, but what else is in my world? What, the sun just set, that was very beautiful. I even felt a bit moved to tears. It felt like a gift given to me. Where did that come from? If God's bad and God created everything, where did the sunset come from?
And then the butterfly goes past us, you know, a really colourful one. It just sits on a, you know, limb of a tree or in a flower next to us, and we're just sort of struck by the beauty of it and the delicacy of it. And we're just going, all of a sudden we're going, wow, like, I'm thinking God's bad, but if God exists, God also created the butterfly, well, you know, and that, I'm finding that quite beautiful. So the sunset's beautiful. You know, I look at my wife's body and I go, that's pretty beautiful. Yeah, I find that really beautiful and attractive too, you know, like there's all this beauty around me that I'm starting to see. And we need to be honest, there is all this beauty around, isn't there? So in amongst the world of chaos, we do see, and particularly when it comes to natural things, we see huge amounts of beauty. But where do you want to go when you go on a holiday? You know, you want to go to the middle of London where all the smokestacks are going up and the pollution is going, or even better, Tokyo on the wharf there, on the, you know, where there's all this just pollution everywhere and you need a gas mask to breathe. That's where you go for a holiday, isn't it? No? Why don't you go there? Kick back and look at the view. Right. Where do we go to? We go up in the mountains or down by the sea or some place with a lot of natural beauty, because we feel attracted to that beauty, right? So we go, okay, you know, I believed or I feel that God is a punishing God because I look at all these bad things happening, but then there's a bit of a conundrum now, isn't there? Like, on one hand, God's a punishing God or God's bad, but because of all these bad things that happen, but on the other hand, look at all these good things that happen every day, and what am I attracted to? I'm attracted to a lot of those good things happening, and I see them happening, and a lot of it's in nature, and a lot of it's not man, but rather nature that I'm attracted to here. And I'm going, well, okay, the same God obviously has some... How does that work? Like, all these children die, but at the same time, there's all these beautiful things happening at the same time, including children being born, of course. And we're looking at it and are going, oh, now, you know, now we're starting to scratch our head a bit, right? Because we need to become open to the fact that maybe we don't know the truth about God yet, even though we do think God is bad. And we need to investigate the fact that, all right, God is bad and God is punishing, but now there's another thing that I think I know about God, and that is God likes beauty. And in a way, that's almost a conundrum, because you've got, on one hand, what you would think is quite evil happening, and on the other hand, what you're thinking is quite beautiful is happening at the same time. And so then I start making up some theories about that. You know what kind of theories I come up with then? Many of you have come up with these theories. It's about the balance. God's about the balance. There's got to be some evil with some good. There's got to be light and dark. There's got to be male, female, even they go there with that, which I don't see how they're opposites, but anyway, we go and we start trying to explain what God is. So we actually write down there, well, God is bad and God likes beauty, so there needs to be good and evil for us to appreciate good. And we start coming up with all those theories, right? And then we go, while that sounds all like it's reflected in the universe in which we live, is it very logical? Like, do you need bad in your life to appreciate the good times? Wouldn't you prefer to have just one series of good times with no bad? Wouldn't that be what you prefer? And then you're saying that God created bad so you could appreciate the good, but you spend most of your life avoiding the bad and embracing the good, don't you? And so we start questioning even those things. And the key is, like, for myself, I keep either a written record of all this investigative process, or at least an intellectually list, if you like, of the investigative process. That's what I do with every single thing I do. Even now I do that too, by the way.
So let's say we get to here. We've got, okay, I know, well, I feel God is bad and punishing, but I also think he likes beauty. All right, so that's a conundrum.
I still don't know for certain either one of those.
It's not, nothing's over here yet. What other question can I ask that might add, that might resolve that for me? So if there is a God, is God an entity? Can I connect to God? Because surely that would help me resolve these things. So then I might start a new hypothesis. So if there's a God, would there be God an entity, or would there be God an energy? How am I going to discover this? How would you discover this?
Now, it is true that I can say that you are an energy. Isn't that not true? You have energy. But could I then go the energy is you? In other words, that you are only energy. Is energy the only thing you are? Don't you have more than energy? Don't you have feelings, emotions? Don't you have passions, desires? Don't you have thoughts? And while all of those may consist of certain types of energy, they're all very, very different for each person, aren't they? Right? So I'm starting to go, okay, this is very interesting too. Another thing, what does this tell me about God? And I can start writing down the things that I'm starting to discover now. Still the things that I think I know or are testing here. So I need to test. Well, all right. Maybe God has energy, but God is not just energy. Just like you have energy, but you are not just energy. Right? Does that make sense? You are more than just a piece of energy, some atoms flying around, aren't you? Because for some reason, your atoms, when I walk past you, don't all of a sudden join onto my atoms. Like, so, atoms look different. So, and my atoms look different to Mary's atoms, and I wonder what's going on. Like, the coalescence of those atoms into a being looks very, very different. And everyone says, oh, yeah, that's genetics and so forth. But if we were just energy, I'd be walking past Mary, and if I've got a lot of energy, you'd think that part of her body would join onto mine because we're made of energy, right? And energy can swap and be attracted to different things. So why is it that I, when I walk past Mary, don't lose a part of my body in the process? Right? Now, don't you be rude about that. And then as I walk past, like, I still retain my sense of being, my sense of self, right? And she's still retained her sense of self. And I go, okay, we seem to have some kind of way of keeping our energy in a place that makes sense. In other words, that joins it to being an entity that makes me, me. And Mary seems to have a way of keeping her energy together that makes her Mary. And she seems to be very unique to many of you. Like Lena over there on the camera, she doesn't look much like Mary, aside she's got the basic same features, like female. But aside from that, you know, there's quite a lot of difference between the two in terms of character, nature, size, everything.
I seem to be able to know that I'm different from Lena, and I get to know Lena and I can get to know me. So we have a sequential life that we can remember and recall and think about. So there's something that's not just...
And I know I've experienced my life, and I know I haven't experienced what you've experienced, because that's been your life. And I don't walk past you. And while I walk past you and I go, oh, yes, he or she's got that thought happening right now. I don't then think it's my thought, because I can know the separation between those two thoughts, and I can know the separation between the two actions. And we start applying all of this, and we start, well, this opens me up to another investigation about God. What if God is an entity rather than an energy? What indications are there that God's an entity rather than an energy? What things in the universe would seem to support the proof that God is an entity? Does anyone have any ideas what kind of things might support that God is an entity?
Us.
Well, yes, aren't we the biggest proof? Like the fact that you and I, or Mary and I, seem to be separate in some way, and probably less so for Mary and I, in the sense that because there are certain things happening that I can feel with Mary and I, but I know Mary and I are very, very different to any of you in the audience. And when I say different, I don't mean bad. I mean that you're bad or that we are, but we feel separate. We have a feeling that we are a different person. You know, I don't walk past you and go, oh, all of a sudden I'm Igor. You know? And I've had Igor's life now, and I've had Igor's experience, and I know... Now, I might be able to learn his experience, and I might be able to see it in his soul, but I still know myself to be a different person than Igor.
And how do you do that?
In terms of seeing or knowing?
No, how do you learn Igor's life? You have a relationship
with Igor. And I ask him questions. And later on, actually, the more developed I become, I actually notice myself starting to actually see Igor's soul and feel what's happened in Igor's life. And I can actually walk past Igor and actually tell him what's happened in his life, but I still know it's Igor's life. It's not mine. I can still feel that.
So we might learn about God hypothesise that God might be an entity that we might learn to know through a relationship.
Yeah. So what would we do to discover that?
To test
that theory. start. Yeah. What would you do to test the theory with a person? you'd go up to the person and say, sit down. I want to see whether you're the same as I am.
Do you like chocolate?
Do you like chocolate?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you like broccoli?
No. You like broccoli? So we start seeing the differences, but then we start even talking about the emotion, like the feelings that we've had, the experiences that we've had in life. Did you have this experience when you were a child? No, I did. What about that experiences? No, I didn't have that, but you did, and so forth. And so we start seeing ourselves as separate entities, but we're starting to enter a communicative relationship with the person, are we not? So if I was now experimenting with this in a sincere way, I would go, okay, if God is an entity, it would make sense that I can talk to God. And it would make sense that somehow I can hear God, even though I'm not really sure how that would occur. Right? Now, I can experiment, can't I, with all of that? I could take actions. What kind of experiments might I choose to do? If we have the mic down.
So I was just going to say that when you've got a relationship with a person and you say, how are you? You're not just going, how are you? And cut off from your emotion. You're actually saying, how are you? And there's a softness to actually receiving how they feel. Yep.
Exactly.
So I remember when I was little, when I started talking to God, I could actually feel it feels so good. Just the fact that there's this interaction between me and this being. So my heart would actually, it would feel like a warm, beautiful feeling that I was actually feeling a connection with something.
Yeah. So, and we can see this again from another hypothesis, and that is that when I interact with you, if I am blocked to any emotion whatsoever, then we just have an intellectual connection, which we both walk away from feeling like
superficial and dry.
Exactly. We don't feel fulfilled. We don't feel any sense of personal emotional fulfillment in a relationship like that. So we could then go, okay, well, perhaps God's the same. Perhaps God is similar to us in the sense that we can't have a fulfilling thing and if we try to just do it intellectually. We have to have feelings involved. So I can experiment with that. I could start actually spending time by myself, seeing whether I can feel God or feel God's answers to me. Do you follow me? So I can experiment, can't I? I can just experiment with that. So I could talk to God, and when I talk to God, have a feeling goes with it. So in other words, it's not a bland thing anymore where I just intellectually, Hail Mary, Mother God, yeah, God, and so forth. Not like we were taught when we were younger, but now what I've got going on is a feeling with God. Like, I really feel like I want to know. If you exist, I want to know you. That, and as a feeling.
Some of us might even start with, you know what, God, I've really got the shits. You're bad.
Yeah. and that's my feeling. Now, can you show me something, firstly, to prove to me that you're not? But also, like, I'm still going to talk with you because I still want to know whether I'm right or not. Because at this point, I don't know whether I'm right still, do I? It's only when I'm sure that I'm going to know whether I'm right or not. So, and that's going to be also something that we feel as a truth with a complete certainty with us. And by the way, once it gets here, you'll be life and death on the issue. Do you know what I mean by that? In other words, you'd be willing to die for that particular truth, not out of anger or fear, but just because you know it's the truth and that's it. And nobody will be able to shake you in that place. If we just have the mic go back.
I've talked to God a lot, but I don't feel like I'm being talked back to. So am I blocking God?
Well, that's another question we need to put into this pile, isn't it? So if I'm talking to God a lot and I'm not getting any answers, either God doesn't exist or I'm not hearing her. It can only be one of the two things, really, can't it? Now, if I feel that there's proof enough to around my universe to show to me that God must exist, then the second option must be the truth, that I'm not hearing her. Why am I not hearing her? Okay, and then we start feeling, well, all right, let's go for the feeling side of things again. When I'm talking with a person, if I'm just talking from my head to their head, I'm not really feeling them either, am I? Like I sit down with a person, And I've got to question them, how do you feel about this, how do you feel about that? And even if I'm questioning them, a lot of times I'm not feeling it from them. I'm not feeling a rapport with them in any way, I'm not connecting. But then all of... Sorry, go ahead. Say.
Yeah, and if I'm also saying to them, yeah, no, I'm fine, yeah, I'm really good, yep. Oh, a bit of stuff going on, but I feel great.
Which is not true.
Yeah.
So it might
and
be like huge...
The worst week of my life.
Yeah.
Then are they going to really feel me? Are they going to really... Because I'm not, like Laura said, I'm not creating the openness there, am I? I'm not going, I can hardly tell you how bad it's been, you know? And that immediately that's... I've opened...
And then this person here goes, I don't want to hear how bad Mary's been for the week. See you later.
I just realised you saying that. I sort of feel like... Why would God care if I've had a bad week?
Okay, see? So the real feeling in Evora at the moment is actually, God doesn't care for me. How can God care for me? Why would God even want to care for me? Like, I'm just this little ant anyway. Like, there's, like, you know, how many billions of people on the planet? 6.5 or nearly 7 at the moment, billion people on the planet. And what, you're telling me that God actually wants to have a relationship with me?
How is that even possible?
How is that even possible, for a start? But secondly, if it is possible, well, why would he want that? You know, I'm just this little ant. I'm nothing, really. You know, I feel like I've been, and many of us have been taught that we're nothing from our childhood, of course. And so we feel like nothing, so God must see us as nothing too. Right? So what we do is we put that in that pile. Be honest and put it in the pile. So put that feeling you have about God in that pile. I haven't yet tested the truth about it, but from my experience in my life, that's what it seems. It seems that God can't care about me. That's what it seems like. Do you see? So for many of us, what we've been doing is we've been talking to God, talking to God, talking to God, but actually we have a lot of these emotions about God that we're not being honest about. Can you see that? Like, we have emotions that, some of us have emotions that I don't even know whether God exists. Some of us have emotions that if God does exist, he doesn't care about me. If God exists, he's only a male. How many of you ladies feel that? Right? How many of you men feel that if God exists, he's only a male? And so forth. We have a lot of belief systems about God, and that seem to be true because of the life experience we've had, don't they? Like, for yourself, Evora, there is a feeling definitely in you that God can't care about me. You look at my life. It doesn't feel like I've been cared for by God in my life.
Then I get all conflicted because I think, all right, if I'm whinging to God and, okay, I've got things to whinge about, but I'm not somewhere in a slum in India and I'm not hungry. And then I think, well...
Yeah, Mum and Dad pulled out that card early in your life, didn't they? You got to eat your dinner because...
Well, they gave it to you. They gave it to you. And you ran with it.
Yeah, because, you know, they handed you the card. You've got a whole plate of food in front of you. There's a lot of people in the world that don't have a whole plate of food. You eat it. That's one of the cards that gets handed to us very early in life. In other words, you're not allowed to have a bad feeling and you're not allowed to make your own choice because I'm telling you other people have got it worse than you have. Right? And this is a very early day card that most parents play on their children in order to manipulate them into doing what the parent wants. Right? So while I agree that that has been an experience in your life, we're still not certain that that's how God is with people. Right? But it is a feeling we have. Now, be honest with your feelings with God. God loves your honesty. Now, when you think about it, if we don't even know that, we can test that. What we can do is we can say, all right, I'm going to, for a whole month, falsify every feeling that I have with God and see whether I can feel God in that process. Now, you could even experiment with that with your neighbour. And you go, you know, when you walk out and you're feeling terrible and they say, how are you? You say, I'm fantastic. I'm, you know, like, you falsify every feeling and see how good the interaction is. And so you can experiment with the neighbour and go, yeah, that didn't work very well. Like you might be in a relationship with somebody or a friendship with somebody, and every time they come and ask you how you feel, you tell them the opposite of how you feel and see how that works. Right? And then the next month, do the opposite of that and ask yourself, well, with that experiment, did I feel connected or not? You see, what we do is we don't experiment enough, do we?
we get to this, we go, yep, my childhood was bad, I went to church, it was really, I didn't get it, and I didn't really like the people there, so, and then really bad stuff happened in my life, and then I felt guilty about feeling about that, so clearly God is bad and punishing. End the experiment. You know, lots of people out there have definitely done that, haven't they? And we don't keep questioning, asking, what do I know for sure?
So for yourself, Avera, often what you do is you have these feelings about God that you're almost afraid to have. You know, the feeling that maybe God doesn't care about me. Oh, I can't feel that feeling because that disconnects me. But it's a feeling you have inside. So you need to feel that feeling inside.
Has anyone done that experiment and just like raged at God and felt like this is not fair and you've totally abandoned me and I don't want to do this anyway, and suddenly, oh, there's God.
I can feel a bit of God's love coming. Oh, okay, so you do exist and you do actually. You heard that one at least.
But you seem okay with that.
I feel like if I tell the truth about my true emotions, people run away.
Many do.
People, it's just like, oh, do not want to know, do not want to know you, do not want to connect with you. And then I just feel rejected.
Okay, so now the question we've got to ask is God like that?
I feel like he is, because I'm so angry at God.
I agree. You feel like he is. But can you see that there is a possibility, and this is why it's still in this pile, there is a possibility that you only feel like that because of your experience in your life. And you're actually imposing your experience of your life upon God. So in other words, there is this possibility, and this is another thing I'd write down. Okay, at the moment, I feel God just doesn't want to listen to any negative emotion I have. Right? So I write that down.
And I've got to be a good girl, then God will love me.
Yeah, only time God loves me is when I'm a good girl, and I make sure everything's nice and fluffy and warm and lovely.
How do you do that if you don't even know what a good girl is?
Exactly. That's another question that I need to resolve in this. Can you see this? Can you see how many questions we have? You know, so when you really start opening up this process, and this is why most people don't embrace the process, is because initially when we start opening this process up of being questioning, we've just got thousands of questions. And we look at the pile of questions and we go, gee, where's like, how am I ever going to resolve that list of questions? And so what do? We get all those questions and we roll them all up, we put them to one side and say, I'll get on with life. And if one of those questions come up at some point in the future, I'll have a look at it. That's what we do. But when you're dedicated to resolving these questions, you'll find you'll get them resolved very, very rapidly.
And that's what I was going to say. Once we start this process of going, okay, maybe God's an entity and maybe it's the honesty and the emotional openness that creates connection with us, between me and God, then things can move really rapidly.
So I can now start being honest with God. Look, God, to be frank, I think you created a bit of a crap universe, actually. And the laws that you've made, I feel, if they're laws at all, like, because it feels like to me there's a lot of anarchy and no law, but if there are any laws at all, why don't you give us a book or something? And then some religious person comes along and says, oh, he gave you the Bible. What? The Bible's full of crap. Like, I can't even read the Bible without it contradicting itself half the way through. And then in the first half of the Bible, it talks about God being a punishing God, which is exactly what I'm saying God is. Like, so how can you say God's a loving God on one hand but a punishing God on the other? That doesn't make any sense to me. God's either one or the other, surely. Hang a sec. No, we talked about this yin-yang thing, didn't we? That's right, where evil and good had to coexist. Is that what you're telling me? No. Okay, so you're telling me God's always good, but we've got all this bad on the earth. How did that all happen? I've got, you know, we don't resolve those questions. We actually get this list of questions if we're honest with ourselves, a list of very, very good questions we need to resolve.
Like a lot of us have been told, no, you just have to believe this. You just have to know that God is good. Can't you know that God is good? Come on. Like, you would know if you knew God, you know God was good. You know, and a lot of condescension, and we're guilted into feeling like, oh, I don't have those feelings. It makes me seem like I'm ungrateful and there's something obviously very wrong with me that I don't know that God is good. And we get shamed into not exploring this whole beautiful process, which, remember, I said is like the most important journey of your entire soul. It gets all shut down because we feel guilty, we feel ashamed, and we feel like, oh, I'm not good enough, I'm just the one in the back who everyone's like crying and praying and, you know, and I just kind of pretend that I'm there.
Yeah. And then I have this situation happen where, you know, I ask Mummy, the question, you know, the question, a series of questions often, of, Mummy, if God's always good, then why do people die? And you know what happened when many of you asked that question, if you ever were brave enough to ask your parent who's going to church that question? You get a little tap across the face sometimes, or how dare you say God's bad? And, you know, like you get the anger-based response to shut you down rather than it being an honest question that you need to ask. And so what happens when there are questions about God is we're taught not to ask them. Can you see that? Like, you think how much in your own life you've been taught not to ask the questions that need to be asked about
or
God.
Or absorb the feeling from your parents that you'll never resolve that. Just forget about it. You can't know.
And many parents get upset because they personally have not resolved the question, and they're just as confused and angry about the resolution of that question as you often are, or even more so. And so when you ask the question, they just respond in rage. Like, how dare you even ask that question? Or, you know, they go down this track of trying to deny the process of even answering the question. Because many parents don't want to do this. They don't want to say, look, darling, I've got no idea. But it's a wonderful question. And perhaps we should investigate it more thoroughly, huh? Because we all feel, many of us feel that these questions are unresolvable. And since they're unresolvable, what's the point of asking them? And so what we do is we close down this whole field of investigation about God. It all gets shut down. We investigate science, we investigate, you know, cultures, religious formats on earth, and we investigate religion, but we don't actually investigate God. Even when we investigate religion, we're not really investigating God, because we're investigating the religion's interpretation of what God is. Right? So we're still shut down quite a lot from investigating God.
Oh, I just wanted to say, once you ask the question and you get an answer back, the first answer back feels really liberating, and it makes it really exciting to ask more questions.
I agree.
And to get more answers back. So the more you ask, and if you have that real longing, it's just... Like
it's wonderful.
Yeah, and it makes it easier to ask more questions.
Yeah, so. It was Adele, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yep. Now, Adele, I'll put to you though, the answers that come back could also be coming from an alternative source.
Yes, they could.
So now we've got this additional question. Was that wonderful answer I just got from God, or was it just from a person in another dimension that I can't see, that I think is God?
And you have to trust by asking more questions.
Exactly. You've got to keep asking questions.
That is the beautiful thing. Everyone just goes, oh, my gosh, there's too many questions. Some of you are like, no way, I can't do this, there's so many questions. But that's because there's no wonder in this process. You know, if we just go into it going, okay, whoo, I think I made a discovery. I think something that's here could be going over here, but I just have to keep asking questions, then we can stay invigorated by this process. Yep. If we get really fearful and go, no, I have to know now, and I can't keep asking all these questions, it's taxing, you know, then we're going to get really tired. And that's where our desire for, you know, desire for the process can lead us. And I guess the more you develop in the process, the more trust you have in it.
So every single truth that I've ever resolved personally about God and the universe and all of those other things have been resolved through this process for me. So, and please bear in mind that this side here, the shore side, I need to say a bit about it. It's not just what you feel and know is the truth, actually, because there is this other aspect to the truth actually entering you, and that is that it has to be actually an experience. So in other words, I can postulate to you that we can walk through that brick wall there. Theoretically, that brick wall is made of atoms, my body is made of atoms. Is that not true? Well, that's another theory that I'm presenting to you. And if that's the case, if we are made of the same of matter, then it would make sense that I could somehow align my matter, if I had control over my matter, and somehow align that matter, if I had control over that matter, and I could physically walk through that brick wall.
And you might even be able to explain all the science of that to us. Tell us exactly how that would happen, and you've discovered this new truth, and it's all going to work like this. And so you could stand up here for 3 hours and tell us how you could walk through the wall.
Right.
For sure.
And then when I walk through that wall, now all of that fact, although being presented to you as fact, now becomes proven, does it not? By the experience. Do you follow me? And it's only by the experience that what we feel and know as truth really becomes truth. So there are many people on the planet and in the spirit world who think they know the truth, they think they feel the truth is a certain way, and yet they have not had the experience, and so therefore they cannot still say for certain.
So it's like they're up there going, yes, I know the science, this is for sure. I know that this you are atoms, the wall is atoms. It's possible to do it. I can explain it to you. I can tick all the boxes. It is a sure thing. But they've never actually done it. So they haven't had the experience. And that's the difference. They can even say, no, it's in this pile. But unless they've done it, it's not there.
It's not in that pile yet. Until you have personally done it, you will never have anything in that pile. And it's very important that we're honest with ourselves that it's yet to personally happen. So I can talk to you about God till I'm blue in the face. And I can tell you that God will give you her love if you long for her love, and talk about how to long for her love and all those kind of things. But until that personally happens for you and you recognize it as the truth in the experience, it will never become a fact. And you can talk about it all you like to another person, and it's still not a fact. And it's still never going to be a fact until you've had the personal experience of it happening to you. It's the same with the law of attraction and all the other laws of God. Exactly the same principles apply. Now, instead of judging the other person's experience, because every experience has to be a personal experience, instead of judging it, we just need to recognize, okay, I have yet to have that experience. And since I'm yet to have that experience, I can't say for certain whether that thing is true or not true. However, I can also go through a whole set of experiences and understand everything that's happening about certain things, and then I know for certain that thing is true. And I know for certain what is being said is true. And so the way, a lot of the things that I'm presenting to yourself as truth can only be presented because I have personally had the experience of that truth. That's the only reason why I'm very definite about what I'm saying to you as truth. Many times you'll ask me a question and sometimes I'll go, oh, I don't know. A child in a recent presentation put up her hand and said, who created God? And I said, I don't know, because I've not personally had that experience of knowing that particular truth. So I can't answer that truth. And I actually said to her, I don't know anybody else who's had that either.
But you said it's a good question.
It's a wonderful question. That's still in the all the things I don't know box. Does that make sense? And there's quite a lot of things in that box still. In fact, what you'll find is that God has created this beautiful universe where there's so much in that pile that you'll spend a lot of your life enjoying the discovery of it. The only reason why we don't enjoy discovery is because we were taught not to enjoy discovery by our parents.
And not to enjoy this state of I don't know.
Not to enjoy that state. But not only that, we were taught if we didn't know something, that we were stupid, dumb, idiot. You know, there's a lot of emotional attachment to us not knowing things. And then when we got to this phase and when we started to experiment, when you experiment, by definition, you are going to make a mistake. How do parents feel about mistakes? Like, you pick up a glass, you're a little child, pick up a glass, it's mum's precious glass. She's only got 6 of them. They were come from her married when she got married, and she's so attached to that because that was a special gift by somebody. And all of a sudden it gets fumbled, and bang on the ground. And what happens? It was a mistake for many, but what happens? Now you get this barrage of very negative emotions from your mother. Even she might even scream at you and say, "Why did you do that?" And you know, get all this terrible.
And so, your little you's just going, "I was just testing
the field." So your little you who's down here, looking up at this ogre now who's yelling and screaming at you, is going, you know, what do you do now? What have you just learned about a mistake?
Don't test the theory unless you're sure, you know.
You know, you might have just been testing the theory with glass bounce.
Or the theory that I can use my hand like mum does.
Yeah. You know, and yet as soon as we test a lot of these theories as a child, we automatically get punished and therefore we become so afraid of even making a mistake. So I put to you that many of you are very afraid of making mistakes, yeah,
and
in your life.
It's key, like for this whole process to work, you have to have a vital ingredient. And it's the ingredient that will actually speed up your discoveries.
Yeah.
Desire.
And the fear of making mistake doesn't help desire very much, does it? Like, if you're so afraid you're going to make a mistake in every move you make, how are you ever going to follow a desire you have? Right?
And lots of people who have come to talks in the past have come and gone, "Wow, this is fascinating, but, well, what if this is a mistake?
What if it's wrong?
What if it's wrong?" And no trust in themselves, in the fact that they could go, "Well, if it's wrong, then I'll just go back to the drawing board." You know, there's so much fear that shuts down this huge explorative process.
Yeah, and many people in the future, once, you know, there's a lot of media attention that's being focused our way now, and sooner or later that'll go to the mainstream media, and many of you will, you know, get accused of being in a cult and all these other things, which you know you're not in, but anyway.
Maybe it's still in there, I don't know.
Yeah. Maybe it's still in your own I don't know category. I agree. Or maybe it's in your no idea category. But just the fear of the potentiality of making a mistake that can be judged by others, and you'll feel that. And you're going, "Whoa, yeah, that's pretty big actually, like how manipulative that can be in terms of this process of experimenting." So most of you, the beauty of what we're trying to create, myself and Mary, is that we're trying to have no strings attached to everything. So you start to learn then that you can experiment without any form of punishment. In other words, you can on one hand go, "Yeah, I can go along the talk and listen," and then 3 months later you go, I don't believe that, and yet AJ still comes up and gives you a hug every time he sees you or something, and shakes your hand and doesn't treat you badly. But then so you know that even if you totally disagree with everything I'm saying to you, you're still not going to be ostracized or criticized by myself, right? And the reason why is I feel God does not ostracize and criticize anybody who's in an experimentive state. And she wants you to experiment her universe.
But she created.
She created.
If you look at a child,
you to experiment.
Which is the most pristine form of ourselves, what are they doing? They're asking questions, they want to learn, they want to experiment, that's their way of doing it. And it's not just an intellectual thing, they're doing it with their whole body all of the time, and their emotions, and they're stepping right into that experience, and whoop, they fell off the chair.
And they're not afraid even, like they fall off the chair, bash their head, you know, got a great big lump coming up, and the next moment they got back on trying to get back on the chair again. They don't give up just because they had a little bit of pain in the process, right? Because it's only when they were punished for the process that now they have huge amounts of resistance. Now, this is something we need to be aware of, that God, if there is a God, God is not going to punish you for experimenting in a universe that's full of experiments, right? So God wants you to experiment with different things. And the key is to feel as you experiment. And if you feel as your experiment, you'll find, but even that at this point might be a maybe, you know? So you can see how almost all of our life is either in the I've got no idea or maybe. And it's only when we know and feel the truth and we have the personal experience that it will become a solid fact, Right? Now, many people in your life, throughout all of your life, have told you that there is this fact and there's this fact and there's this fact. You grew up actually reading history books where facts were presented, so-called facts, that are not actually true. They're just the accepted societal fact, but not actually. And then there's a whole series of facts about history, for example, that were never presented. There's all this truth that nobody's ever discovered about, like the truth of our nation, for example. Like, how many of us get taught in our school, in our childhood at school, about the genocide of the Aboriginal race in Tasmania, for example?
Or the stolen generation. Oh, they might teach that in schools now, but...
How many of us, when we were young? Yeah. The reason why is because society has certain things they don't want to accept as facts, even when they did happen, because there's a lot of emotions connected. So while we keep everything as we possibly can, either in the no idea or this, it's only through the knowing and feeling of the experience that it will become this. Now, what a lot of people do, and these people become what you call philosophizers, they live in this area, never wanting anything to become that area.
They love this area. They like create a glowing facade of this is a wonderful place to be.
And it is a wonderful place to be, in a place of experiment.
But to stay there.
But at some point, something must become known as a fact for you to actually embrace a happy life and for you to actually embrace knowledge, right? And so in fact, if that hadn't happened in your own history, many of you who flew here today for today's meeting would never have been out of fly because of somebody not knowing and feeling and then experiencing the truth of flight, for example. That would never have occurred.
Because this whole process isn't one of indecision. It's not like, oh, so many questions, I don't know. Oh, ask another question, I don't know.
And it's not a process of philosophizing.
No.
Where I'm just coming up with idea after idea after
that's
idea.
That's a beautiful idea, and think about the aspects of that idea.
And I'm only just enjoying the discussion of it.
Yeah.
But rather, we want to at some point know for sure whether what we're discussing is true. Don't you? Don't you want some surety at some point about whether it being true or not?
So I can love this process, but I really want this pile. Like, I want it a lot.
Hmm.
And that's the desire that will pull me through it, and also the desire, when you harness this desire, guys, and you go, no, actually, what they're saying, I think I want to try out. I'm just going to start with one, and when you really desire it, watch how quickly you start to get answers, or get more information anyway. Things that you might not have thought about God for 20 years in a really sincere way, and then you go, no, I really want some more info on this. You step into a whole other interaction, and bam, someone you don't even know on the bus is going, have you ever thought about God? You know what I... And you're like, wow, okay, I've attracted something else. Or you pick up a book in the doctor's waiting room and go, whoa, yeah, that's really... I'm feeling that more. And suddenly you're in this process that was ignited by your desire for truth, but it had to be, like, you had to have the desire, the true desire.
Now, the only difference between myself and someone like the Wright brothers, you know, the Wright brothers who came up with that first flying machine, sort of, well, it wasn't the first, but it was the first that was documented successfully as working. The only difference between myself and them is that I've focused on the truth about God first, whereas they focused on the truth about flight first. But basically, we used exactly the same principles. Do you see that?
And you know, the Wright brothers, they weren't very intellectual about this whole flight thing. Yeah, they used their brains. They were quite logical. But I bet they didn't sit back and go, you know, maybe we should work on that plane thing. You know, like there was a lot of feeling.
Desire, passion.
Desire, passion, emotionally engaged. When it crashed, they felt it.
And not only that, whenever they read every book that said flight is not possible, they go, yeah, we might as well give this up. Because they say flight is not possible. Did they do that? No. And so whenever you read a book that says, oh, you should give up this investigation of God, or, you know, God's not real, but that's not a reason to give up the investigation at all. It's just following somebody else's opinion, right? So how does everyone feel about that process? Does it make logical sense to you as to embracing it? Yep.
Because that's the other thing, God is logical. This, all this emotional stuff, there is logic to what we say, you know. We don't just say, just feel everything, no matter what you want, wherever you are. It's okay to bash up on your partner as well. You're angry, feel it. No, there's a logical sequence to the way God has designed this whole process of connection. Hmm. And it is about, like, even though we're in our emotion, there's always logic. And love is a very logical thing.
Hmm. Love is. And to be frank, you could even rub that out if you wanted to discover things. And you could put love, what's the truth about love, in there, right? What's the truth?
Love's just put up with everything.
Love's painful, hey?
Yeah.
Love hurts. All of us know that. Well, is that a truth? You know, that's what we all think we know, but is that the truth?
I've got a curiosity with the process of when you resurrected. In that process, you show that there was no death, that there was an afterlife, and you returned. The witnesses of that experience were all of a sudden shown that it is possible.
Yep.
And I want to know, would that have seeped into their soul as a sure, or yep. did they write it off saying, but that's the Son of God?
Well, they had personally seen it.
So is that their experience, or do they go, that's the Son of God, that's Jesus, and he's different?
Well, I can answer that.
Mary was there, so.
I don't know if you remembered that.
Yeah. Well, I would say there was a surety in my soul that, wow, you're not dead. So there's something beyond this existence, and that was in my soul. But it didn't make me sure that after he was gone again that I could still connect to him. So it didn't give me all the surety about the spirit world.
So the experience is not just even feeling it and seeing it, it's it happened to me.
Mm.
Yes.
So that sure,
yes, I was there.
That sure pile is really, I mean, to have
it's really small. For most
two
of us.
Things there is a great accomplishment.
It is.
Yeah, it
that's
is.
What I'm saying. It's a precious, precious thing to put yep. one thing in that pile. And even to have this pile go down and this one come up and a few things wavering
yep.
is amazing. Most people in their earthly life do not even...
investigate at all. Yeah.
From a heart space. Yeah.
My feelings are if you've got even one thing in this pile, you're doing pretty good.
That's just how I was feeling. It's like even if I'd seen that, my immediate thought would have been, but he's different, he's closer to God, like write it off for myself as an excuse not to enter that.
Yep.
The curiosity would be, can that be possible for me?
Don't forget now? That I had told them that it was for them. So for 3 years prior to that happening, I had told all of them, including Mary the most, that this was what's happening for me can happen for you too.
But even in this day and age, with us not physically being there, we celebrate Easter and we go to church and we learn about Jesus and we don't go, can that be possible for
me? Yep.
Right now in this time, this individual soul,
exactly.
this returning and experiencing an afterlife.
Yeah, and one of the reasons why myself and Mary and others return was because we want to demonstrate to you the changes that occur through our life. So as you see our lives blossom, if I could use that term, you will see the changes in us, the changes in us. Once we become at one with God, you'll see that change happen again and, you know, what we'll be able to do after that point. And all of that will give you the personal faith that you can do it for yourself, because we're saying to you, you can.
Well, for me personally, huh? Seeing the shift in Mary from the very first DVD and obviously over a year that I've been listening to it.
Thank gosh, I'm shifting from there.
But for me personally, you have been the biggest inspiration that... you know, having that desire for God, the softness in you, the vulnerability in you, the confidence, like every single aspect of your soul just keeps shining. Even when I just look at your face on the computer, I feel more love from you.
Yeah.
And that's how I know it on a soul level that there's always a progression and an evolution of your soul.
Exactly. And the interesting thing, Laura, too, is that many of us have spent a lot of our time talking to people about the truths of what we're learning, and we don't yet really fully appreciate that one fact that you now appreciate with Mary, and that is it's not been Mary talking about it that's necessarily convinced you anything. It's actually Mary changing that's caused conviction in you.
It's actually been your emotion when AJ is doing the talking. Like in the beginning, I would feel your embarrassment and your sense of like, what am I doing here? I don't know what to say. Always looking for reassurance. Like it was the feeling.
There was anger in there. Yeah. Stop talking about that. Like there was a lot of yucky
and now you having your plate, you knowing, or you, I don't know if it's in the sure thing, but definitely feels that way to me that you have your place and your expression. Yeah. So it's just through that the feeling that I've got more faith.
Yeah, and that's the beauty of this process of personal discovery. Like Mary, it doesn't matter what I say to Mary. Mary is not going to have a personal experience until it goes through the whole process. So it's actually impossible for me to convince any of you the truth of what I'm saying. Right? All I can do is put it together to you as firstly a theory. Then, hopefully, through my own life and through people's lives who follow it, it gets demonstrated to you as more fact, as a demonstration to you. And then it's a choice inside of you of whether you want to embrace that or not. And then when you decide to embrace that, you'll start to have personal sureties as you go through that process. We don't expect everybody to just drop everything and say, yes, no, that's true, bang, off they go. It's not like that at all. And in fact, it's not ever been like that for both of us. So we would never expect it to be the same way for yourselves. This is the process that we've both had to actually go through with the discovery of every truth. And I'm still going through that process, and Mary's still going through that process, and every celestial spirit we've talked to you about still goes through that exact same process, and eventually they become sure through the personal experience.
And I really treasure when people are just vulnerable about where they're at. The reason we started to talk, we've been wanting to talk about getting to know God for a while, but what sparked this idea to do this talk today was at Easter time, we were sitting around the table with three or four other couples, and one of the guys didn't put up his hand.
Almost, though.
Yeah, he was very anxious, and he just quietly said to us, look, I can't get into my emotions. I feel like I'm just really stuck. And both of us turned and said, it's not about your emotions. Don't get lost there, you know. This is about God. And he was sitting with his wife and another couple who were pretty, like, going, you've got to do emotions. Like, this is about emotions. You're not doing them. This is not going to work.
You know, and you're the black sheep of our little group because you're not getting into your emotions, you know, that kind
but
of thing.
Just his willingness to be vulnerable. And then he ironically, we started talking about God and explaining this process, and he started to tear up. He felt a connection then to what we were discussing. Mm. And I just thought it was precious that he opened the room, really, in just his ability to say, look, it's all over here for me. I don't get it. And we ended up discussing quite a few things that were totally relevant for everyone. Just as, like, wouldn't you agree, this talk is pretty relevant for all of us. So, yeah, it's beautiful when we can just be vulnerable about where we're at. God loves that too.
It was interesting. 5 days ago, I was actually in my head about law of attraction triggering this, that, and then I just stopped and I just asked God, what is it really about? And all of a sudden I saw a sunflower turning towards the sun. And I just cried for an hour because it made me realise it's just about my heart longing and feeling and receiving the nourishment from God.
Yeah. And it's those personal experiences that help solidify your faith. You know, until that point in time that you've had the personal experience where you have some surety, there's not going to be much faith there. And instead of punishing yourself about it, you say, oh, I just don't have any faith yet. And that's another thing that's in this pile. You know, I don't understand faith yet. And that's okay. I'm allowed to be in that place. God's not going to punish you from being in that place. Yeah. Diane?
When you first start to get a little bit of a knowing experience about a question, can that just then continue to build through more experience? Because I'm just starting to, like, wonder how much of some of the things that I've started to feel that I know would still be in the maybe, just because of that.
And
wondering.
I kind of feel like for me, Guy, there's like a mini jump step pile in the middle where I go, okay, it doesn't really feel like a theory anymore. I kind of really feel it's true. Like, it would take a lot to sway me from this now. I've got enough evidence, I've had enough mini experiences So it kind of sits here, but it's not quite.
But when somebody criticises Mary for having that experience, then she goes into doubt. And that's proof that it's still really in this pile. Does that make sense? You can have all the criticism in the world aimed at you, all of the, you know, stuff coming at you from everybody on the planet, once you've gone through the shore, from that moment on, you don't sway. Yeah. And it's not a place, it's an interesting place, because it's not a place of arrogance either. It's not a place of like holding on to a belief just because you want to hold on to a belief. It's not like that at all. It's very different to that. It's a very humble place of knowing that you're definitely sure about this particular thing, and nothing can sway you. But it's not because you're arrogant about it.
It almost feels to me like a quiet knowledge. It's a quiet surety that no one can take away from me. You don't all have to agree with me. I don't have to shout it from the rooftops, but it's just something I carry with me always.
And in fact, I'd put to you that if you do get upset with somebody else about them attacking your surety, then you're not sure. You're just not sure yet. Because the truth is that once you're perfectly sure, you do have a solid sense inside of yourself that is okay with attack from others.
Thanks.
Yep. If we go next to you, sorry, and then we go right back.
Hi, Jay. My question is, what is that like to be one with God?
It's a very good question. Very hard to describe, but can we maybe give you some analogies that will help you understand? Firstly, at the moment, in the course of a day, how many times do you act on a fear-based thing? Like where you're afraid of somebody's opinion, or where you're afraid of what they'll do to you if you do something wrong, or do you find yourself doing that quite frequently?
Not really.
Not really? Mm. So everything you do in the course of a day is totally what you want to do that day?
No, not really either.
Okay. Okay, so once you're at one with God, everything you did today would be exactly only what you wanted to do today. However, it would also be harmonious with love of every single person and every single creature around you.
Including yourself.
Including yourself.
Yeah.
Today.
There's a lot of freedom there.
Right, so...
It's a very free state.
It's a very free state, yeah. So you imagine in that moment that every single moment today, all you've ever done was do exactly what you desired, but you were also automatically, without having to try, you were also automatically loving in every single thing you did. You didn't have to think about it, you were just automatically loving. Right? So that's partly what it's like to be at one with God. Secondly, how many times in the course of a day do you have a doubt about something? So you ask yourself a question and you don't really know the answer. Or you have doubts about your interactions with others, where you go, oh, maybe I did the wrong thing there, or, you know, or maybe they did the wrong thing with me, or, you know, and, well, that never happens when you're at one with God. Even when somebody's yelling at you, you still don't feel that it's the wrong thing. Right? So you still love them even when they're yelling at you. Like you actually have a feeling inside of you of love for them while they're yelling at you. Right? Imagine that. Like normally what happens when somebody's yelling at us, what do? We start getting defensive and we start shutting down and we get maybe a little bitter. Some of us want to run away because we're afraid. Others of us want to stay there and, you know, fight. And for some of us, we might even want to have a punch up. You know, like that's how we feel in terms of response. But none of those feelings will come to you at all. It's not that you try. You won't need to try. It will just be automatically none of those feelings come to you at all. Just automatically with no trying at all. So you imagine that you don't have to try to be loving. You imagine that. Just that everything you did was automatically loving, but you didn't have to try to do it. It was just all smooth process where you just love anyway. What else can we describe that?
Well, the biggest thing is that you feel in this constant love connection with God. So you're feeling connected to God and this amazing love. And you're open to receiving it. You're not feeling unworthy. You're not feeling like, oh, it's too much, it's overwhelming, or I don't deserve it. You're just feeling love coming from God in a constant way.
So in every single moment, you don't question that you're loved.
You know it.
You know that you are.
You're having the experience. Yeah.
So because you know that you are, when somebody treats you in an unloving manner, you don't bite their head off because you know you're loved by God. No matter how they treat you, it's not going to make any difference to what you know in this relationship you have with God. So they could treat you angrily, sad, they could try to shame you, they could talk about your past, all these darkened things that we did in our past. They could try and physically hurt you, but you'll still know that you're loved by God in that moment. And you don't need to defend it or anything like that. You just feel that love in you. So you know how many of us in the course of a day will look in the mirror and go, oh, you know, I'm not that happy with you, you know, the reflection, you know, where you look in the mirror and go, yeah, I wish you looked a bit different, like I wish you were a bit taller, or I wish you were a bit this, or a bit slimmer, or whatever. And you don't have any of those feelings either, ever. Like, there's an automatic acceptance of everything that you are, and ironically, everything you are is the perfect you could be anyway. So any weight you would have had by that stage, you would have lost. Any old age you have by that stage gets younger. All of these things happen. So all the things that we're often critical of, you know, the grey hair that appears, well, that goes away, and so forth. So you look in the mirror and you are the perfect example of what you can be. And so you're automatically not critical of anything that you see in the mirror either. So you imagine walking down the street, you're not self-conscious at all. You're not worried about what anybody thinks of you.
Everyone in the room, oh yeah, I can feel they've got this, I can feel, you know, they've got these emotions coming out of me, or they're not really loving themselves, or not really loving me even, but I just love them so much.
Now, one thing that's really challenging for yourself, if I would put it, is another aspect, and this is you will be truthful with everybody at every moment without fear. Does that make sense? And you find that a little difficult at the moment. So you imagine walking along the street, right, and because you just have a feeling, you know how sometimes you walk along the street and another person looks at you and you look at them and there's this sort of connection going on and there's some reason why you need to talk, but you don't really know, right? But because of different emotions we have, we don't talk to them, right? We go, oh, you know, you sort of don't look at it and then you walk past. And well, those events, you don't do that with anymore. You just go, howdy, how are you? Like, and if they open up in that process, you will engage automatically. Does that make sense? You're not questioning their response to your love anymore.
And you're in a state of total trust of God's laws, trusting that God will care for you.
So you're not scared for your life, for your food, for your clothing, for your shelter, for your existence. You don't plan ahead anymore. So you know how we go, like, who wants to go overseas? What do? We get all these brochures, put them all over the floor or on the table. We start analysing, would this be good? Would that be good? What's my comfort levels and what do I need and all these kind of things. Very few of us just go, I'm going tomorrow without a plan.
I've got the desire, let's go.
You know? And unfortunately, with the life we have today, you know, you need a passport, which means you have to plan something. But in the future, when you're at one with God, you won't even need a passport. Nobody can give you a passport. You can go everywhere on the planet where you want to. Like, so how can everyone give you a passport? You won't need a passport. So you just go, you know, I feel like going to
Tanzania
today. You know? And you're there. Because that was your desire. And you'll go there for sure. As soon as you have a desire, you'll act upon it. Right? So you'll also walk along the street and there's someone you're really attracted to, and if you're single and all of a sudden you're walking along the street and there's someone you're attracted to, and you go right up to her and you go, I'm really attracted to you. Now, you might not touch her, right? But you're like, I'm really attracted to you. She goes, what? I don't know. I can't explain it. I'm just really attracted to you. But you won't feel bad about what you've just said or the action that it's caused in her either. You'll just be truthful and honest in that interaction. Then another thing that will happen is you'll go up to a person and you can feel they have a certain injury, and their injury is that they would actually, under normal circumstances, do something for you if you asked them. So that was their, that's their injury. That they'd do anything for you if you asked them. And you go...
Whether they wanted to or not.
And you go, oh, I can feel that injury. I do not want to ask this person anything.
Why would you do that?
To allow them to feel the emotion.
Not just to allow them to feel the emotion.
Because my asking them would be helping them stay in an addiction. So I wouldn't.
And so I wouldn't do it.
I wouldn't want to support anyone in their addiction, in things that I know that harm them and cause them to not love themselves. I just couldn't do it.
I just can't do it anymore. So I can't manipulate anybody into doing what I want them to do anymore. Right? It is just automatically out of the question for me to do that. Does that make sense? That's what happens when we become at one with God. We don't manipulate people through their emotional injuries anymore. Right?
And that's so, the moment most of us do that a lot of the time.
So you imagine, you've worked all day. You're the guy in the house. You've worked all day. The lady of the house stayed home all day. You come home, there's no meal made. In that space, what would you do? You would automatically make the meal. You wouldn't even ask her to make the meal, and you wouldn't imply to her that she's been lazy all day, and why hasn't she got off her big backside to do the meal, right? You would never say those things because the feeling in you is not even there to say it. The feeling in you is not even there. So these are all part of what it feels like to be at one with God. Yeah. Pretty nice place, isn't it? Yeah. And that's the thing is that, we often, again, what I've just said to you about that subject, write down at one month. Now, AJ just said a whole series of things that he feels is the truth about the at one month condition. How am I going to work out whether it's true or not? It's the same process. It's the same process. At the moment I'm in, I've got no idea whether that's true. It sounds fantastic, but I don't know whether it's true. It could be just somebody's pipe dream, you know? Quite often I'm accused of being an optimist,
idealist.
Or an idealist, or having a highly imaginative soul. And while that is true, these are actual experiences myself and Mary have had. So, but you don't have to believe that. You can start at this point. I don't know. I've got no idea. Let's see what happens in this process of growth towards God to see whether that kind of thing will happen or not. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Who feels like once they reach a moment with God, who needs a pile anymore? Like that's the ultimate. Because the truth is, it just keeps going. You just keep going in this process. Like
you get so...
Your pile gets bigger, but you really want to look at what I don't know. You're like, doing this got me to this really great place, so I want to keep doing it.
Yeah. So you actually learn that this process of discovery of truth, which is what we've tried to describe in a fairly basic, rudimentary fashion, this process of the discovery of the truth... In the case that we raised it about was about God, but actually this process is a process that once it becomes a part of our soul, it's a process you will use in your everyday life with everything that you ever come against. And you'll just use it automatically. You know, it'll be what you do to discover everything. And so just because you've become at one with God, you won't stop. And just because you become at one, like imagine if I become at one with God and I go, right, I'm at one with God now, I'm happy as Larry, right? As the saying goes. Although I've never met a Larry who's been that happy. But anyway, so I'm very happy. And if I just said, that's as far as I'm going and that's all, and I didn't have this pile of which I had no idea about still, I would never have become at one with Mary. In that process, I would never have gone through the soul union state. And if we'd never done that, we'd never have, you wouldn't even be watching us right now because we'd still be in the spirit world, right? Because we couldn't get here in that place unless we got to that place. So almost everything that's ever happened to us in our lives that has been really fascinating and interesting and also enjoyable, and some of the things even that have been not that enjoyable, the last, have all been the result of us taking this approach that we're willing to continue the process of discovery without judgment of ourselves or without judgment of another in that process. And if you can do that, you'll find that your life will just grow and expand and grow and expand, and it'll be a continuous growth and expansion. Yeah.
Shall we have a break?
Or should we, maybe if we ask one more question from, and then we'll have a break, huh?
I sort of realise why I've stayed in self-reliance. Like, it's safer with the things I think I know.
Yes.
I don't even want to know about the things I don't know.
Yes.
Because then I'll be made to feel stupid. And I don't want to test because then I could make a mistake.
And then you feel...
And then, yes.
Yep.
And I realised that desire was the key. So my question, Mary, is about... did you find that the two process your injuries, if you had an ear around feeling stupid and making mistakes, before you could do this, or just step into the desire?
Well, I think the desire, I built the desire, Joy. So I built, I read about God, I thought about God a lot more, you know, and I still had those fears of being humiliated, especially of making a big mistake and being humiliated. But the desire led me through that. You know, the example I gave earlier to Elvira of when I was leading the mediumship team, I had a strong, solid desire to stay loving. I didn't want to waver from that point. And because of that, whoa, my fear got triggered and I came out the other end of it. And I maintained because I desired to be loving so much, I was willing to be humble in the process. And I feel it's the same in this journey. If I grow my desire, if my desire is strong enough, then I'll be willing to feel like, oh, I made a mistake, that feels yucky in the process. I don't know, would you add to that?
No, I also feel, though, that Mary had to release some of her emotions in order to do that. You see, we have a lot of emotional hooks into both of these two areas. And yes, one of the best things you can do is start addressing some of those emotional hooks that you have in them. So for example, just how often do you say to another person, like, I've got no idea?
I never used to say that at all.
Exactly. So there's an emotional resistance to you admitting that you've got no idea. Now, obviously, if you've got an emotional resistance to admitting it, then it's going to be very, very hard to actually examine everything that's in that pile, that all of which you have no idea about. Who has an emotional hook into feeling wrong or making a mistake? But most of us, don't we? Like, it's very rare for a person under today's environment to not have a feeling of a fear of mistake, of a mistake. Like, quite often, early days, Mary would say, I would say, I would like to go and do this. And Mary would say, but we haven't got the funds to do that, or we, you know. And I'd say, well, that doesn't matter. Like, why is that a limitation? And it's only a limitation because of our fear. If we make a mistake and we've spent $1,000 making that mistake, we're not going to get that $1,000 back, and then we'll be $1,000 poorer, and we'll have made a mistake with $1,000 as well. So we'd rather not do it. And I'd say to Mary quite frequently, I've made a lot of very expensive soul-based mistakes.
AJ always says there's no price on your soul.
There's no price on my soul, right?
If you've learnt through the process, it wasn't wasted.
Yeah. So if it costs you, like, let's say you decide to move to another country, and then 3 months later you decide, oh, I've got to move back. Like, I don't view that as a mistake. Now, you might have spent $50,000 or $100,000 doing that move, and I still wouldn't view it as a mistake. Does that make sense? And if you have an investigative process going on, nothing's ever a mistake, really, like, in the process.
I guess if you think, like, how much money have you guys spent on spiritual growth development, you know, over the years?
You know, all the courses you did and all the religions you've donated to and all of that. If you added all that up, how much would that be? It'd be a fair significant. For some of you, it's probably in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, right, over the years, all adds up.
Huh? But if at the end of it you get one thing in this pile, was it worth it?
Of course it's worth it.
Yeah.
So I, well, it was still worth it because now you know what's in these piles. Do you know what I mean? Like, so in other words, we often in that process discover what is not true for certain. So you know, like I go along to some kind of a religious format or New Age thing, and we start dealing with crystals, and they start talking about law of attraction, and they tell me, I've just got to think my way into positive thoughts, and when that happens, my life will change instantly, and I'll be, you know, that's my law of attraction. And I'm there thinking, 5 years later, there's still not much difference in my life, and I go, maybe that doesn't work. Right? So that's something that I can put in the shore as... I'm sure that doesn't work. You know, you're still getting some kind of answer, right? And that's really important, because if you don't eliminate what doesn't work, a lot of times you'll never discover what does.
Yeah, so, and maybe that's the true answer to your question, Joy. Now, maybe I was a bit glib in the desire thing, because really what I grew in 2 years before this really kicked in for me was humility, was the ability to go, oh, you know, like, I might be stuffing up, or, you know, I'm more willing to see what's really inside of me. And yeah, that helped me step into this process more.
Yeah.
Like, growing the humility enough to go, if I make a mistake, I'll put up my hand, you know. That really wasn't there 3 years ago.
I think that's what the first 2 years has been about.
I actually, before I came to Earth this time, I've always enjoyed making mistakes. This time I found it quite difficult, because the projection of the world on you when you make a mistake is quite severe. Like in the last 6 years of my own progression, I probably could name all my mistakes on one or two hands that I've made. But it's constantly getting flung at me. And not only that, like, come up with the media stuff coming soon, you'll find that that'll be their focus of attention, all of the mistakes that I've made. And if you worry about what other people view as your mistakes, you won't progress, honestly. But in the world we live in, there is such a hatred for mistake. Like, it's like people hate it, like, because they have so much internal fear about making mistakes. So for example, many people go, it would be a mistake to go along to one of those AJ lectures. I've heard people say that to their friends. Right? That it would be a mistake to go along. And I'm thinking, well, how could it be a mistake? Like, a mistake is only something that, you know, well, I don't even think there is such a thing as a mistake, really, to be frank. But a mistake would be to do one thing and then it not work, and then to do exactly the same thing again and it not work, and then exactly the same thing again, and to do that 15, 20 times and it still not work, and then the big mistake would be to do it again. You know, that to me is the mistake. It's never a mistake to try something new that has some form of logic or something associated with it for certain. Why would that be a mistake?
And everyone goes, you can't trust. You know, it's all about trust. If it's perfect, then we can trust it. And I now feel that if someone came up and just said, you know what, I've made 7 mistakes, and it demonstrates the humility of the person. Since breakfast, I've stuffed up in 7 different ways. Well, I go, okay, well, now I'm dealing with an honest person. I can trust honesty a lot more than someone who presents this facade of, like, oh, I've been a perfect mother, I've been a perfect daughter, I've been a perfect housewife. I go, well,
my law of attraction is going AWOL, but, yeah, you know, everything that happens in my life is pretty bad, but I'm still perfect. Right.
So we view mistakes as untrustworthy, whereas I feel a humble person owns their mistakes and I feel more trustful them.
Yeah. So I feel actually that one of the things that Mary did with your question is that she allowed... Before then, she was quite rigid about mistakes, weren't you, babe? Like,
and fear of humiliation.
Fear of humiliation from mistakes.
Saying, you know, she could feel it in the first DVDs. I was terrified.
Yeah, and then a fear of other people knowing your true state even was something that Mary had to get over as well.
Not,
you know,
lovable. That was my feeling.
And I had to get over that too. Like, you know, when I first remembered all the details that I've been teaching you over the last 3 years, one of the feelings I went through was this terrible feeling that I had was, oh no, like, I've just got my life together and I've just got everything quite happy. And now I'm going to say that I'm Jesus to people. Now, how much is that going to stuff up my life, right? And I had huge fear associated with that. and a huge fear of everyone would just focus on my mistakes. And so for a period of time, I decided that it was better for me not to say anything at all. And I went through 3 months of it's a bit hard for me to not say anything at all, as you realise. So I went through 3 months of that, and that didn't work very well. You know, I felt quite bad about myself in that place. And then I went through the place, all right, I will talk about the truth, but when anybody asked me how I know, then I wouldn't say anything about that, right? So then I tried that. And so what happened is that I was so just so afraid to just be me and be perceived as a person who's made mistakes that I actually wanted to be perfect before I spoke the truth. Many of you actually have this going on too, right? You want to be perfect before you actually speak the truth. But the problem was, if I did that, I would never have met, I still wouldn't have met Mary even now. We met 3 years ago. I would never even have met her.
And for me, that's horrible. Like, not only would I have not met my soulmate, but my whole soul progression wouldn't have begun. I would still be that angry, fearful, demanding, controlling girl I was 3 years ago. So.
I only met Mary by embracing my desire to speak the truth, but also by speaking the truth about who I was.
And you had to be humble.
Her own family had me in their living room because I was saying that I was Jesus, ironically. And if I had never said that, they wouldn't have even had me in their living room. That's the irony, right? And this is what happens for most of us, is that we're so afraid of making a mistake, we want to present everything perfectly. We don't want to embrace this process of desire, not understanding that the next set of enjoyable things in our lives can't happen without firstly embracing this set of enjoyable things and growing from that experience. And this is what this viewpoint of truth is all about. This is a growing experience. It's not something where somebody just tells you the truth, like AJ gets up here and tells you what he thinks the truth is, right? And everybody goes, no worries, we all believe that, as if that happens, right? And throws away their life in the process. That's not what happens. Like, for majority of us, we have to go through the... And to be frank, I feel all of us have to go through this experimental process on our own desire. Nobody else can make you do it. Nobody else can force you into it. Nobody can manipulate you into doing it even. It's something that you need to embrace for yourself if you want to continue growing in the universe that God's created for us to grow in.
And to me, that's really beautiful and teaches me a lot about God. God wants me to know myself. God wants me to take responsibility for who I am. And the more I do that, the more I connect with God. That's really cool.
So let's have a break now for, shall we, half an hour or so? And then we'll answer another question. That question took a while.